no. Heaving from my ribbed breast, oh, holy.
N-O-T-I-N-V O-T-I-N-V.
N-U-R-M-U-R-S-O-F-T's incredible dreams of every D-A-Y, gnawed in the limbs and the senses of my body that cheer you and dismiss.
Houses this facility, the LIVELab. So a few words about the LIVELab for those of you who haven't been here before. The LIVELab is a unique performance space, but it's also unique because we do a lot of research here. So we're interested, for example, in how musicians communicate with each other and how audiences and the musicians interact. We also study a lot of special populations. We look at how music can benefit, for example, people with autism, people with movement disorders like Parkinson's, and we're also studying performance anxiety, which is of interest to a lot of musicians. The LIVELab has a lot of equipment systems in it. If you look along the sides there in the back of the stage, you can see some cameras. These are actually infrared cameras, and with them we can measure the movements in great detail of performers and audiences as they play and experience music. We can also measure brain waves. We can put caps on people's heads, and we can measure whether they're musicians or whether they're audience members. We can measure what's going on in their brains when they're listening and when they're performing. Don't worry, we're not going to do that tonight. So the thoughts that you have about what you're going to hear tonight will be safe inside your own head. But come back another time, and we'll try to figure out what you're thinking. The LIVELab also has an incredible active acoustics system. We have 28 microphones and 76 loudspeakers in the space. And with that, we can recreate anything from a really dead space to something that, see, the technicians are helping me out here, that sounds like a cathedral, just with the flip of a switch. And we will be really showcasing the acoustic system tonight. You'll hear sounds coming from all over the place, and different acoustics and different reverberations, and so on. So I'd just like to thank a few people. Of course, the staff and technicians at the LIVELab who've worked hard to put this on. So Dan Bosniak, who's sitting at the back there, is the technical director. Ranel Sanadara is our sound engineer and does a million other things. Dave Thompson, JJ Booth, and many other technicians were crucial to getting everything going here. finally, I'd like to give a big thanks to the Insight Foundation. Insight helped put on this whole series of What Next concerts, but in addition, I'd like to give them a special thanks because they gave us the funding to commission a new work by the very talented composer Abigail Richardson Schulte, and its premiere will be tonight. It was written especially for the LIVELab, so thank you very much to the Insight Foundation. Abigail to the stage to say a few words about tonight's performance.
Well, good evening, everybody. Welcome to the Hamilton Philharmonic Orchestra's What Next Festival. This is a very exciting festival. This year happens to focus on the voice. Most of our concerts this year will be operatic in nature, but as you can see today, it's a little bit more of an intimate setting, and we'll get to see the voice in many different forms. Before I talk a little bit about tonight, I'd like to give a special thank you to our funders. Of course, the Insight Foundation for the Arts, as Laurel has already mentioned, is a great funder of our What Next Festival, but also the Canada Council for the Arts, Robert and Peggy Savage, and the SOCAN Foundation. Yes, thank you very much. And we are just delighted to be here at the lab. All of us have really enjoyed putting this particular concert together, partially due to the wonderful care we've had here at the lab. It's just been such a treat. And now this festival, we are very pleased to be presenting some works by many Canadian composers, often written fairly recently, and some of them world premieres. Tonight you'll actually hear two world premieres at this concert. And we're also able to feature some of our fine local professional singers, such as Bud Roach. And we've also partnered with a Toronto organization called the Center for Opera Studies in Italy. And with that partnership, we're able to present some fine professional young opera singers from across the country. So tonight you'll be hearing Chelsea Van Pelt and Christina Haldane through that partnership, which is very exciting. And tonight we have some guest artists visiting us. We have Cecilia Livingston, who will have a piece in the second half, and we have Gennaro Lawson, poet, who will, well, I'm gonna drag him up on stage at the end. And also we have Brian Prince, booksellers here, selling some of Gennaro's works that I used in the last piece. And we also have a world premiere by local composer John Lang. For every festival, we do like to feature the work of a local composer, and John has written this piece specifically for tonight, which is great. And now let's move on with the concert. We will now hear a piece by Dean Bury. He's a Toronto composer who's really made a name for himself in opera and writing for young people. And so now we will see and hear The Sun and the Moon, the sun represented by the soprano and the moon, the tenor.
Thank you.
losing my breath, replace the light, but cold and brushed gray.
Good evening, and a little introduction to my new work, Revival. Upon receiving the kind invitation to write a new composition for this What Next Festival, I set out to write text and music for a story which actually does have some personal significance with regard to life challenges that one or two of my family and friends have faced up to. It is also a story to which I am sure many of us can relate, and at the end it offers one possible solution. A young person, in this case a musician, loses a loved partner through a tragic accident. She is thrust into the throes of grief in her despair. She finds herself unable to find any work, including as a singer, which has always been her passion and joy. Without the sense of freedom, she sinks deeper into what to her has been interminable despair. The watershed moment is when her three siblings reach out to her, offering an abundance of love, care, and support. This love and understanding helps to revive her spirit and to give her life and hope so that she can resume her life and sing again. I suggest that you may want to follow the words of the poem as the work unfolds. It's in the poem, the lights will be brightened in the auditorium for that purpose, if you wish to. There are various ways in which I'm tapping into the acoustical possibilities of LIVELab. First, the opening vocal duet, which is actually a flashback in time to 3 years before the main part of the story, is heard through speakers in a particular reverberant setting, almost cathedral, that Laura referred to illustrate the joyousness of the couple still together in their Helicon days. Simultaneously, as the couple sing together walking across the meadow, the sound is heard to move as if with them from left to right of the auditorium. The main part of the work sounds at a normal acoustic level for this concert hall, with the greater reverb reappearing at the end with music from the opening in the closing measures. I do hope you enjoy this new work, Revival.
Thank you.
Thank you. machine.
Vibrating through
our sopranos. So Chelsea Van Pelt sang John Lang's piece Revival, and Christina Haldane singing the pieces by Dean Burry and Cecilia Livingston. And now please join me in welcoming to the stage our HPO principal flute, Leslie Newman.
To be here tonight. I just wanted to say a few words. I notice you have probably everything I have to say to you about this piece in your program already, but in case you haven't read it, Noa Noa is the Tahitian word for fragrant. And this piece was inspired by a woodcutting also called Noa Noa by Paul Gauguin. And in addition, the text that I speak as I am playing is from a diary that Paul Gauguin kept while he was traveling in Tahiti during the years 1891 to 1893. So these were things that inspired Kaija Saariaho to write this very evocative piece for flute and electronics. For me, it's such a pleasure to play. I had the great opportunity to meet Kaija Saariaho last February. She was in Toronto, and she is such a gentle and lovely and beautiful, inspirational woman. And you know, in Japan, perhaps you've heard that they have this wonderful thing called where they select certain artists as their national treasures. And Finland, Kaija Saariaho is Finnish, and in Finland they have the same thing. So she is the national treasure of Finland. So that means that she's paid an artist's salary to be an artist and to compose, which is such a lovely, lovely thing. She actually lives in Paris and composes beautiful music. This, hard to believe, is almost 25 years old, this piece. And it's a real pleasure for me to play it. One last little thing. You can see that I'm working with a program here that was written by her husband. It's not me being looped. It's actually segments, 63 different segments of sounds that are pre-recorded that I have to engage at certain times in the piece, and I do that with the foot pedal. So I get to pedal, hopefully always in the right place, 63 times. And that's something that took me a little bit of practice to get my pedaling in the right place. At any rate, this is Noa Noa by Kaija Saariaho.
Thank you. my name is Cecilia Livingston, and I wrote the next piece on the program, which is called Two Dreams for Soprano and String Quartet. So I thought I'd just take the opportunity while I'm here to say thank you to Abby Richardson and to the Hamilton Phil for having me as a part of this festival, which is absolutely extraordinary. Also, a particular thank you to the LIVELab. What an extraordinary space, and I'm just very intrigued to be here and to hear all the things that can be done in this beautiful, intimate performance hall. This piece came out of a sort of strange moment, one that I think we all have at some point in our lives, which for me took place in Northern Ontario. I had the opportunity to go and visit a lake that I had spent a lot of time at as a young child. I hadn't been there for many years and went back and had the extraordinary sensation of coming across my younger self again, as though I somehow saw my younger ghost. And I think this is going to be a really interesting piece to hear after the Syriacan piece that we just heard, which was in its own way very ghostly and eerie, particularly being in this amazing acoustic. I think you'll hear in this piece two things that kind of draw out that sense of uncanny ghostliness. The first thing is in the strings, these quarter tones, notes that are sort of in between the keys at the piano, the pitches that we might expect. And they help the music to have this sense of sort of sliding in and out of focus, kind of like a Doppler effect. If you hear a siren going by on the street, and suddenly it shifts and it changes into something eerie that's almost recognizable and yet disturbed. That's the first thing I think might be useful to listen for. The second thing that I think, quite by accident, only realized after I started writing it, gives a strange atmosphere are the harmonics in the cello, which ghost or echo the singer's lines. I think that also sort of has something to do with the two dreams of the title that we have in the sense, two singers. I think this is an experience many people have been lucky enough to hear this piece several times, which for a composer is kind of ghostly because every time I hear it, I hear those previous performances and my own imaginings of it, and it comes alive in a different and new way. But I think this is an experience many of us have had, and I hope it's evocative for you, and I hope you enjoy it. Thank you.
Thank you. Still,
final piece on the program. Before I get into this piece a little bit, I'd just like to tell you how special it is to be here, and for us this is really something quite different for us. As many of you know, the Hamilton Philharmonic Orchestra is Hamilton's professional orchestra, and our home is the great stage at Hamilton Place. We're used to presenting full orchestra concerts for 1,500 people, usually with traditional repertoire like Beethoven and Tchaikovsky. And really, so our string players sit in a sea of string players. And this is the time of the year where they can come forward and say that they would like to do something a little bit different, explore perhaps other parts of Hamilton in some of our venues, and also explore some new music that's written today. And so, as well, musically, they get to become really sometimes soloists and chamber players. So this is a special time of the year for all of us. And I'd like to thank them for their hard work and dedication in putting this festival together. Thank you. And if you didn't get a chance to pick up our What Next Festival magazine on the way in, I hope you will do so on the way out. We still have a couple of events next week. On Wednesday, we have a chamber orchestra concert with Voices at Christchurch Cathedral. And on Friday night, we have a cabaret late night, well, late night for classical musicians at 9 p.m. it's wild and crazy operas. I wrote one of them called The Perfect Screw, and it really is about screws, I promise. It's really quite fun, so I hope you'll come and check out those concerts next week. And now, I'd like to talk about this piece. First of all, I'm very grateful to Laurel Trainer and the McMaster LIVELab for commissioning this, and the Insight Foundation for supporting it. It is really quite a treat to think about writing a piece for a space and trying to, well, imagine about what type of piece would be appropriate for it. And I thought, well, for one thing, I'd like to have some visuals at some point because we have these great screens here. I'd like to use the piano and, well, I'd like to use some playback because, as Laurel mentioned previously, there are lots of speakers here and they can actually move the sound around. And I also wanted to use the work of somebody local, and I decided on Gennaro Lawson, who is a longtime friend of my husband, and Gennaro was actually best man at our wedding. He's a poet, he grew up in Dundas, and he has seen some remarkable success lately. His book, Sidewalk Flowers, has won more prizes than I can imagine, and I think being published in 17 countries now. And one of my favorite quotes about it is from the New York Times. It says that this book belongs on every coffee table. And interestingly, in households with or without children, because it is a children's work. And what I'm particularly drawn to in Gennaro's work is how he effortlessly moves from writing poetry for adults to children. And personally, that is really important to me because I find I'm doing that as well a lot these days. And I find that my children's works are often almost more effective on adults. And so I decided to really combine the two in one piece. And so the first movement uses Gennaro's poetry from a book called Enjoy It While It Hurts, which, by the way, these are all for sale outside, and I think we can get Gennaro to sign some books afterwards if you'd like. And so I took four poems from a collection called Shade Garden, where he really brings out the human characteristics of certain plants. And then under the whole really umbrella theme of plants and flowers, I chose Sidewalk Flowers. And so that is a wordless picture book. And so we'll follow along the story very much like a soundtrack. And in this particular movement, I actually decided to use the instruments to give them a very specific role. So the voice, for instance, which sings without words, represents the child in the story. And the piano represents the sidewalk flowers. So whenever you see flowers on the screen, then we'll hear a little piano gesture. And the string quartet represents the increasing use of color throughout the work. And then, of course, there are environmental sounds and soundscape that float around the room here and there. And so here we have the world premiere of Sidewalk Flowers. Thank you.
Thank you.
ivy chokes smiling. A shade garden.
Oh, wind, oh, mischief,
toss into the moist and furrowed bed of earth, the queen's furry child. You keep going back to where there's nothing left, acting vexed and upset, looking sad and perplexed. But if you keep going back to where you can't go back to, you'll never get to go where you might get next. La-di-da.